welcome again to our worship service. So again, it's good to see all your happy faces. I see that there's joy in the house, and that is part of what we do. We sing joyful songs unto our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. At this time, if you will please be kind enough to join us and stand as we have our call to worship. Thank you very much.
Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Let the children of Judah rejoice.
Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Morning. How's everybody doing today? Good. Amen, amen. I know that nothing else is happening today because no one's keyed in on what's happening at 1 o'clock and at 4 o'clock today because today is the opening week of NFL football. All right. There's life again. There's reason to live. I'm kidding. Good to see you all today, and welcome online for those that are here online with us. And we want to start trying to remind you to silence your cell phones. We've been having somewhat of a rash of folks' phones going off, and I assure you that if God is going to call you, He's not going to use your cell phone. So you don't need your cell phone for the hour that you're here, at least not on ringing. So if you could just silence your cell phones, sign in, please, on the attendance sheet pads and pass them along. Let us know that you're here. That would be great. Our prayer focus this morning is on our 2025 budget. The leadership team is beginning early to try and, solve the unsolvable mystery of balancing the budget for next year. So please be in prayer for them and for us, and be in prayer for your participation in helping in us completing our responsibilities to the budget and to our church. Volunteers are needed for parking for the games, and the home games. Please see Charles. And also volunteers are needed for fixing the meals for away games for the varsity team, football team. So please contact Stacy Jones for that. This Saturday, September 14th, we have the movie On the Lawn, which I'm really excited to go to. Anybody can come, no matter your age. Everyone is young enough and to come and be a part of that. We're going to be sharing popcorn and having fun out on the movie On the Lawn. And if it's raining, we'll be in the COC. I do want to remind you that there are scope cards still remaining out there to be bought. And folks that have scorp cards would love to talk to you. So, please pick up your statements for July, from the beginning of the year through July, in the back. They're still in the back there for everyone to pick up. Also, a couple of other announcements that might not be up on the screen. On the 22nd of September, there's a family outing. Please see Shauna for that. They're going to Pelican Beach. And also on the 27th, there's family game night as well. And Shauna will be sending out more information about that. So let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer to begin our time of worship together. Thank you, God, for being here, for calling us your own, for calling us and in your mercy and in your grace for all that you've done and are going to do. And so we want to focus on you this morning. We lift up our hearts to you. Spirit, just move and work and anoint this worship service for your glory. And we thank you for all your wonderful love and acts of kindness and mercy towards us. We want to be the people that you have called, and we want to be the people that reflect your glory and reflect your ways to the world. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and greet each other as we begin our worship. Let's stand.
Again, Heavenly Father, we are in thy sanctuary worshiping you today, understanding how powerful your name is. For demons tremble at the sound of that name, Jesus. And we call upon you this morning to accept our worship with our whole hearts. We come here standing in your presence, understanding you are King, our Lord, our Savior. You are everything. We just want to thank you for your magnificent grace, your magnificent love that you've shown to us this week. And that's why we're here, to thank you for the things that you've done for us in the past, the things that you're doing for now, and we in advance thank you for what you will do. So as we go through this worship, we ask that you would lift every burden that is in this building, every burden of those that attach to us and family, friends, or loved ones. Help this country to realize that you are still in charge. Help this world to know that you're King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and you're still on your throne. And you're looking for a people that serve you, and we want to serve you with our whole hearts, so that when you return one day, we want to celebrate with you forevermore throughout eternity. Jesus is Lord forevermore. This is our humble prayer. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen.
Lord, we thank you that you call us children and that you've adopted us as your own. And we can come to you without fear. We can come to you with our concerns and our trials and tribulations. You know them. And you await for us to tell you, but you're already working on them. So this morning, as we worship you and as we already are trying to open up our lives to your healing touch, that you would continue to go deeper into our lives and free us from our sin, free us from our doubts, free us from the lies that we hear or that we've been told about ourselves, about the world, and about you, and help us to come to you unafraid. And so we lift up our hearts together. We know that that you are working in every situation, even the situations we don't understand. Lord, we pray for communities like the one in I think it was in North Carolina or in Georgia that had that shooting this week. And that was just another horrible event of the taking of lives. And Lord, how we continue to use violence as a way of expressing ourselves and dealing with problems. And we need, Lord God, you to heal us from all of that. And Lord, we just pray for the families and those that are dealing with this tragedy. And the ongoing war in Ukraine and the violence there and in Gaza and in Palestine and in Israel, Lord, they're all your children. So we need to pray for peace and for the innocent and for those that are suffering. We also pray for a peaceful resolution. Lord, I know that that seems impossible, and it's been an ongoing struggle for many years. Lord, we just look to you for your guidance. And Lord, just be with those who are in our community who need your healing touch. Pray for Linda Gersa. She had to go to the doctor in the emergency room this week, and they had to cancel their vacation, so they're home. And Joe and Linda, and just pray for them and ask that you would put your healing touch on her life, on her foot, and also for Pat, who had knee surgery, our secretary, and Lord, many others who are dealing with issues and with news that is not encouraging. We pray that you'll lift them up and give them hope and bring life to their lives, even when the news is not so great. And help us to come alongside them, as you call us to do, to carry each other's burdens, to visit the poor and the needy, the prisoner, to feed the hungry and clothe the naked, that we too would take care of each other as the community of faith, to show that by our love, we are your disciples. And so, Lord, we thank you for today, and we thank you for the children, and we thank you, as we're about to release them, that you would touch their lives and just speak to their hearts this morning through their lessons. And so we lift up our hearts to you with the words that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespass, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right, may the children go to Children's Church. May we have the ushers come forward for a time of offering. This too is a sign of our worship to God through our tithes and our offerings. Lord, bless the giving of our tithes and of our offerings. Move us and help us to trust in you for all things. In this way, Lord God, may you use these offerings for your kingdom, for the building up of your kingdom all over the world and the spreading of your gospel. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Goes in my soul, I hear. sing in the troubled times. Sing when I win. I can sing when I lose myself.
Amen. That's a great song. I love that song. It's good to be together in the house of the Lord this morning as we continue to worship God together. This morning we're going to start a new 8-week sermon series that will lead us right up into November. And through November, actually, right up to Advent. So, we are going to be talking about being more than Christian, and today's installment is called Following Jesus. And this sermon series is going to be based on a book by John Mark Comer. It's called Practicing the Way, and John Mark Comer is a Christian author, pastor, who lives in L.A., and he's written a lot about what many would call modern monasticism. And he is a really good speaker and Christian. And I'm hoping that maybe in January to start a small group that we will continue to dive deeper into this this subject of practicing the way together. And so we're going to read out of Luke chapter 5, 1 through 11, and John chapter 1, verses 43 through 51. These are two call stories that we're familiar with. So Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. One day as Jesus was preaching on the shores of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. So he sat in the boat and taught the crowds from there. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Now go out where it is deeper and let down your nets and catch some fish." "Master," Simon replied, "we worked hard all last night and didn't catch a fish. But if you say so, I'll let down the nets." And this time, their nets were so full of fish that they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners into and the other boats. And soon both boats were filled with fish on the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, "O Lord, please leave me. I am a sinful man." For he was awestruck by the number of fish that they had caught, as were the others with him. His partner, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. And Jesus replied to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people." And as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed Jesus. Now, John 1:43 and following. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Come and follow me." Philip was from Bethsaida, Andrew and Peter's hometown. Philip went to look for Nathanael and told him, "We have found the very person Moses and the prophets wrote about. His name is Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth." "Nazareth!" exclaimed Nathanael. "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" "Come and see for yourself," Philip replied. As they approached, Jesus said, "Now there is a genuine son of Israel, a man complete of integrity." "How do you know about me?" Nathanael asked. Jesus replied, "I could see you under the fig tree before Philip found you." Then Nathanael exclaimed, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God, the King of Israel." Jesus asked him, "Do you believe this just because I told you I had seen you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." Then he said, "I tell you the truth. You will all see heaven open and the angels of God going up and down on the Son of Man, the one who is the stairway between heaven and earth." Let us pray. Lord, open up our minds and our hearts to what you want to say today. Help us to not only understand, but to absorb and abide in your truth. For only by your truth and by your life can we have hope, be renewed and transformed, and to be like you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So being more than a Christian, I know that that might be a little bit of a shocking title for some of you. But being more than a Christian, because you see, Jesus, in everything he did, never was converting people to Christianity. That's something also that you might be surprised about, since we're always talking about being Christian and about Christianity in our talk and our way of life. But really, being more than Christian means following Jesus. Now, we also are familiar with that phrase, but you'd be surprised as we come to understand what it means and what it meant to Jesus and what it meant to the people of Israel, what it meant to the disciples like Simon and Peter, like Nathanael, when they heard Jesus speak to them. It meant much more than I think many of us recall. We talk about Jesus as Savior a lot, and he is Savior. And we really focus a lot of our theology and our expectations about our life as Christians about talking about being saved from our sins. And that's true. But Jesus is more than saving us from our sins. Actually, the majority of how he defined himself and how this all began was that he was first and foremost known as a rabbi. Now, we know this, but we often don't get a lot of the meaning of what that is because we do not know the background and the educational system and the culture with which that name, that word rabbi, was so popular and what it meant to be a disciple. You see, to truly understand him and to know him, we must be more than Christians in the sense that we are now as Western Christians. We must be more than just sinners saved by grace. We need to be followers of Jesus. And Christian doesn't always equate with follower. I think my battery just went out. You can hear me? All right. All of a sudden, I can't hear anything. You see, Christian doesn't mean follower. Because many Christians say they're Christians. Actually, Barna Research Council released this data that says that at least in the West, here in America, 63% of Americans consider themselves Christian. But when they dug deeper, like they asked a question like, do you go to church every week? Do you read your Bible? Do you do the things that Jesus says to do? Especially when it comes to all aspects of your life. And they didn't go that deep. They just basically asked, do you go to church every week? Actually, they said, how many times do you go to church a month? And if people went to church at least once a month, they were considered practicing Christians. And that's the 4% that Barna is saying are practicing that we can equate to possibly being followers. That they're actually reading the Bible and they're actually going to church at least once a month. Now, how would you say that, what would you say about that? I mean, that would include us, right? Congratulations, you're in that 4% of American society that actually goes to church once a month. Now, going to church or coming to a building to be the church, I should say, is a good thing. That's not a bad thing. The issue is that it doesn't make us followers. For example, believing in Jesus doesn't make us disciples. The Bible says that even Satan and the demons believe. And of course, they shudder. They believe. They know who Jesus is. Countless times in the Bible, we see that Jesus encounters demons and people, and they're constantly in fear of him and saying, what do you want with us? Why have you come to torment us? They knew who Jesus was. And in one encounter that Paul had with a possessed man, with a man who actually thought he wanted to have what Paul had, and he was doing all these things. And finally, the demon says to that guy, I know Paul, I know Jesus, but you, I don't know. I don't know who you are, because he wasn't a follower of Jesus. So being a believer doesn't make us a disciple by that definition. And of course, we know, even though this is hard for us to take, that Bible knowledge also doesn't equate or doesn't automatically make you godly or make you a Christian. There's many Bible scholars, academics, I'll just name the most famous one, Bart Ehrman. He is one of the most respected biblical scholars in the world, and he's pretty much, at best, an agnostic now. He doesn't believe what the Bible says, though he knows it better than you and me. He teaches Bible. He teaches New Testament. He's written books about Jesus, but he's not a Christian. So Bible knowledge itself doesn't make us disciples of Jesus. And this is something that we need to be aware of. And this is something that's not new to us, right? We don't like to hear it, but it's the truth. And what did Jesus say about the truth? The truth will set us free. We need to acknowledge this and wonder about where we are in this thing we call following Jesus. The other thing is that non-religious, non-Christian people have been telling this story to us for a long time. People who are not Christian constantly remind us, hey, you go to church? I don't trust the church. Hey, you're a Christian? Wait a minute. Especially pastors. Do you know that pastors are some of the most untrusted people next to car salesmen in the world? I don't know if you knew that. But you have car salesmen and then pastors. No one trusts car salesmen. And next to them is pastors. And I can attest to you personally that if I'm talking with somebody and they ask me, what do I do after we've talked, you know, and we go to that next level of, hey, you know, what do you do? And, you know, what are your interests? And I finally have to admit that I'm a pastor. I can assure you that that changes the atmosphere of my relationship with people like that. One time, Terry and I were on a cruise, and we were hanging out with these two Norwegian, this Norwegian couple. We sat at the same table several times, and we hung out. We went to see the shows together for two nights in a row, and it was a seven-day cruise. Ten-day cruise. And we went and hung out with them. We saw them at the poolside. We were playing ping pong with them. And then finally, we were at that moment where we were having dinner, and they're like, man, you guys are really cool. And I go, yeah, you know, we love to talk to people from other countries and get their perspective on things. And then they finally asked us, well, what do you do? We're in the middle of dinner. And what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a pastor. And my wife, well, she's a chaplain. And they're like, you could see their jaw drop, their eyes like roll back into their head. And literally, almost very few words were said after that. And after we had dinner, we never saw them again. They avoided us. Actually, I don't know if this is true, but it's attested to Gandhi that Gandhi said, you know, I don't know about these Christians, but I like Jesus. And you've probably heard that. People are not sure about Christians or about the church, but they like Jesus. So what is this relationship between Jesus and his disciples that will help us understand? What is the cultural context that will help us understand what it means to be more than Christian? And what does it mean to follow Jesus? And in the end, you're not going to be surprised, because this is something that you know. It's something that I know. It's something that you probably already do with someone else, or this is how you got your job. Because you see, following Jesus is about being an apprentice. The word disciple in Greek, it's Talmud, and the word disciple doesn't mean really disciple, because disciple is kind of like a verb, like I'm being discipled. The best rendition of the word Talmud, which is the word that is used for a disciple, is being an apprentice. Now, this was the process of becoming an apprentice to a rabbi in the time of Jesus. So when a young Hebrew boy was between the ages of 5 to 12, at the age of 5, he would enter Bet Sefer, which was the house of the book. This was like elementary school to junior high. They would learn and study the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And in those years, they would end up memorizing all of those five books by memory, by heart. At the end, when you became 12 and you weren't quite cutting the snuff, you weren't quite good enough, only the best of the best moved on. If you If you weren't considered good enough to move on to the next level, you went home and you learned a trade. You went back to the farm, you went back to your family, you went back to your town. You're around 12 years old. That was a time for you to learn the family trade and live your life, but you weren't going to be able to continue on. So those that pass the test and move forward would go to what's considered more or less high school and college. And what that was, between the ages of 13 and 17, they would enter what's called Bet Midrash, which is the house of learning. And this would be an official place in the synagogue where there was a teacher and there was a special place for you to go every day and learn. And these were the ones who were promising, you know, prospects. And for the next 4 or 5 years, you would spend all of your time not only learning about Scripture, but you would memorize the rest of the Old Testament by heart. Can you imagine that? Anybody here have the whole Old Testament memorized? Not even close. They had, by the time that they were 17, they had memorized the entire Old Testament, the scriptures that they had. And so at the time that they finished, then the majority of them were sent home. The majority of them were like, okay, it's time for you to go home, get married, have kids, work on the farm, work in your town, get an apprenticeship, do something else. Only the best of the best of the best could move on. And what was the next level? The next level was having to find a rabbi. The next level, this would be like the Ivy League of Ivy Leagues. This is like, going to MIT or Harvard. But the thing, it was even more strict because very few people were able to get rabbis to take them on. And you would go to the rabbis and you would try and convince them that you were worthy of being their student. And not only that, you went to the rabbi that you wanted to emulate. Your desire as a follower of a rabbi was to be like them, to be with them, to be like them, and to do as they did. Most rabbis had anywhere from 5 to 40 disciples. Now, if the rabbi would give you the time of day, if they actually thought, well, you got promise, you got, you're somewhat promising that you might make it, they would grill the person on all things theological, on, how to interpret the scriptures, would have them speak and say things. And it was a big, big, big test. Sometimes it would take multiple times. But the thing is that the rabbi was the one who would grill the applicant. And the applicant was at the mercy of the rabbi. And like I said, it was very difficult to become an apprentice, a disciple of a rabbi. But if you happened to impress one, and they happened to decide that they wanted you to be a part of their school, you would, if you passed the test, guess what you were told? You'd be, okay, come and follow me. The words that a rabbi would say to an apprentice or to a student, to a disciple, to initiate them into becoming a disciple, was always, okay, you can come and learn under me. And from that moment on, they were that rabbi's student, their rabbi's disciple. And what did that mean? That very second, that person would then spend 24/7 with the rabbi. Wherever the rabbi went, the disciple went. Whatever the rabbi ate, the disciples ate. Whatever they said and taught and did, they taught and did with each other. The whole goal of being an apprentice under a rabbi was to live and to learn how to live and make this world God's good world through being exactly a carbon copy of your rabbi. To follow and to be an apprentice of your rabbi, you would want nothing more than to be with the rabbi, be like the rabbi, do as the rabbi did. And the ultimate goal of being an apprentice, guess what it was? It wasn't just to be an apprentice forever. The ultimate goal of being an apprentice was to be a rabbi. That was the ultimate goal of being an apprentice. So as you followed your rabbi, one day, if the rabbi thought you were ready, guess what the rabbi would say to the student? The rabbi, apparently without any pomp and circumstance, one day would just turn to a disciple and say, "Okay, now, you go." Guess what to do? You go and make disciples. That was the certificate of graduation for a disciple. From being a disciple to being a rabbi. It's incredibly, phenomenally eye-opening to hear how the relationship and the educational system of the time informs us of what Jesus was doing and how radical it was when he went looking for disciples. Instead of being a rabbi who makes people work hard and try and prove their worth, to everyone that Jesus said, "Come, follow me." From the get-go, Jesus was saying, "You're worthy of being my disciple. And two, I believe you have what it takes to become just like me." I don't know about you, and I've been studying this for a long time, and yes, I knew this and I learned it somewhere, but as I reread it and restudy it, it blows my mind that Jesus was so radical and his way of being a rabbi was so countercultural that from the beginning, this is why so many people were constantly saying, "This guy talks, acts, and does things that no other rabbi does. He does stuff the Pharisees don't do. He has authority. He's authentic." And what were they saying? "There's something about this guy that's different than anybody else." But the fact that Jesus was the one who went to Simon and Peter, Nathan. Now, Nathan is the one example where he could have been one of those people who was still in school, or the one of those people that had made it far enough to be eligible to be an apprentice. Why? Because Jesus says, "I saw you under the fig tree." That would be symbolism for he is learned, and that he was in and under the fig tree means he was a man or a good example of what an Israelite should be. And so when Nathan encounters him and he hears what Jesus says, he goes, "How do you know me? You are the king of Israel. You are the Son of God." He doesn't get a lot of credit for saying that at the beginning. And I think that's because, well, in the Gospel of John, we know right away that Jesus is the Word. And so that kind of thing isn't surprising. But the issue is that to everyone who Jesus encountered and he said, "Come and follow me," what he meant was, "You're worthy of following me, and I believe that you can be just like me." And the thing that when he tells his disciples, right, as he's ascending into heaven, before he does that in Matthew and in all the Gospels, go and make disciples of all nations, of all people. He is saying, go and be rabbis to others. What an incredible thing. And this is what exactly he is saying to you and me. To you and me, if we choose to answer his call. You see, we continue to be Christian. And this is why this is about being more than Christian, because in our Western American way of thinking, Christianity is so caught up in politics, it's so caught up in being, just like the world. We're caught up with so many priorities and in so many things that are important. Yes, they're important, but they're not as important as being with Jesus 24/7. Wanting to be like Jesus at all costs. And doing things like Jesus did. And that's why we call him Savior. And that's why we always talk about being saved and going to heaven. But Jesus never talked about that. In the Bible, it only mentions the word Christian 3 times. But it mentions the word disciple over 250 times. And Jesus is saying to us, and especially when you read the Gospel of John, it's no surprise that in the Gospel of John, the first thing that Jesus, that the movement of Christianity is called is Christian, is not Christian, is the way. To be the way, because Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Being more than Christian is following the way, following the truth, following the one who is the life. Being with him, being with him in life and death, doing as he did. A way of being transformed and remade into his image with everything that we are. Our thinking, our feeling, and our searching for meaning has to always go through Jesus. It's a way of declaring to the world that what we're being saved to is not just heaven, because that's a Christian thing. It's not untrue, but it's not the whole story. And I would argue it's not the most important thing. Because you see, the most important thing is go make disciples. And by the way, when Jesus called his disciples and said, I will make you fishers of men, the phrase fishers of men was an idiom of the day where rabbis would say to their students, come and follow me, I will make you fishers of men. We are to live and talk and abide with Jesus, to do as he did, and to live as Jesus being our rabbi, not just our Savior, but the one who forms us and calls us to be like him right here and right now. Being more than Christian is being his apprentice for life. Let us pray. Lord, as we are challenged to reconsider how we view you, there's a lot of things that we know that are true, that there's lots of things that you've taught us, but there's lots of things that we've also not given as much attention to because of how we grew up, because of how we have learned the Bible, and how many times how we learn the Bible is so skewed by our culture and even by our society and even by our tradition as Western Christians. Help us, Lord God, to be redeemed as we recover the essence and the truth and the way in the life of how you were with your disciples in real life, that that would be the same with us, that we would live as if you were truly sitting here, being the one teaching us, eating with us, walking with us, sharing with us, healing us, and challenging us to go and make disciples. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As you go forth today, and as you sit down to have lunch with each other, as you go to the store, as you think about your week, in everything, know that Jesus wants to be with you, that Jesus has called you to be his disciple because he's intimately desiring to experience everything you're experiencing with you, so that when you need him, he'll be there. He's there with you all the time, but he's there with you so that the moment that you call on him, you will see him, sense him, and know that he lives. Go and share that life and that truth with each other and the world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen and amen.